Hello everyone, welcome to this video lecture of Engineering Hydrology. In this particular video, we are going to discuss about evaporation and the factors affecting evaporation. Now, before going into the detailed discussion about evaporation, we should know what are the losses or obstructions from precipitation. In engineering hydrology, perhaps the study of runoff is one of the major topic. The runoff can be obtained by subtracting the losses from rainfall or precipitation. Now, to calculate the runoff, we also need to know how to calculate the losses or the obstructions. Now, all the obstructions from precipitation, such as evaporation, transpiration, infiltration, surface detention, storage, these are considered as the losses in the production of runoff. Now, the study of runoff is very important because this is directly affect the design of various hydraulic structure and thus the irrigation. Okay. Now, so what is evaporation? Evaporation is a process in which the water molecules changes from liquid state to gaseous state or vapor state at the free surface of the water body through the transfer of heat energy. This free surface word is very significant in this particular definition because the water molecules which present in the surface of the water body, those water molecules escape into the gases and travel to the atmosphere due to the transfer of heat energy. See, this is our sun, and due to the solar heat, the water molecules that are present in the surface of the water body, they escape into gases and travel to the atmosphere. You can see here, these are the surface molecules, okay, and these surface molecules are escape into gases and travel to the atmosphere. So, what is the process of evaporation? How this evaporation takes place? Let's discuss it. When the heat energy is supplied to a water body, the kinetic energy of the water molecules get increased. Now, due to the increase in kinetic energy of the water molecules, the intermolecular attraction force between the water molecules get decreases. Now, more and more this intermolecular attraction force decreases, the water molecules start to leave the surface of the water body by converting themselves into vapor or gases and travel to the atmosphere. You can see here, these are the water molecules, right? Now, when we supply heat to the water body, the molecules from the surface of the water body, see, these are the molecules of the surface of water body. So, this molecule from the surface of water body absorb the heat, and due to this absorption of heat, the kinetic energy of these surface molecules get increased. And once the kinetic energy of these molecules get increased, they overcome the force of attraction and escape into the gases and travel to the atmosphere. You can see here, these are the molecules which are having a high kinetic energy. And due to this high kinetic energy, they overcome the intermolecular force of attraction. And once they overcome the intermolecular force of attraction, they escape into gases and travel to the atmosphere. You can see here that these molecules are having a high amount of energy. It means they are having a high kinetic energy. And due to this high kinetic energy, these molecules are having a less intermolecular force of attraction, and due to that they escape into gases. But at the same time, if you consider these molecules are having less kinetic energy. Due to the less kinetic energy, these molecules are having more intermolecular force of attraction, and due to that they are still in the form of liquid, which is not the case for these molecules. Okay. Now, from this flow chart, you may understand the process of evaporation. Now, due to the supply of heat, the surface molecules absorb heat. It means the water molecules from the surface of the water body absorb heat. Now, due to this absorption of heat, the kinetic energy of these molecules get increased. And once the kinetic energy of these molecules get increased, they overcome the force of attraction. Means they overcome the intermolecular force of attraction. And once they overcome the intermolecular force of attraction, they leave the surface of water and escape into gases and travel to the atmosphere. So this is the whole process of evaporation. Now, since evaporation is associated with heating, people may think that it is a heating process. But in actual, the evaporation is a cooling process. But how this is a cooling process? Let's discuss it. So, as we discussed in the previous slide, when heat energy is supplied to water source, the water molecules present at the surface of the water absorb heat. And thus, the kinetic energy of the surface molecules get increased. And once the kinetic energy of the surface molecules get increased, the intermolecular attraction force between the molecules in the surface of the water get decreased. And thus, they overcome the force of attraction. And once they overcome the force of attraction, they escape out into gases. On the other hand, the water molecules which are not in the water surface, means this water molecules, they are having less kinetic energy. Okay, and since they are having less kinetic energy, the intermolecular attraction force between them is more compared to these molecules which are having high kinetic energy. Now, when these molecules are escaping into gases, means when they travel into the atmosphere, the average kinetic energy of the water body get decreased. Now, since the average kinetic energy of the remaining water molecules get decreased, it causes cooling effect. That is why we call that evaporation process is a cooling process. From this flow chart, you may understand that evaporation is a cooling process. See, due to the supply of heat, the surface molecules absorb heat. Now, kinetic energy of the surface molecules get increased. They overcome the force of attraction, and due to this overcome of force of attraction, these molecules escape into gases, right? These molecules escape into gases. And once they escape into gases and travel to the atmosphere, the average kinetic energy of the remaining molecule decreases. And since the average kinetic energy of the remaining molecule decreases, the temperature of the liquid also decreases. See, if these molecules are escape into gases and travel to the atmosphere, then the remaining molecules are having less kinetic energy. Now, since these molecules are having less kinetic energy, the average kinetic energy of the remaining liquid is decreases, and hence the temperature of the liquid is also decreases. And once the temperature of the liquid decreases, it causes a cooling effect. That is why we call evaporation as a cooling process. Okay, now evaporation and boiling are not same. Actually, evaporation is a cooling process as we discussed in the previous slide, but boiling is a heating process. Okay. Apart from that, in evaporation, mostly the surface molecules of the water body participate. But in the boiling, all the molecules of the water participate in this phenomenon. And in the evaporation process, bubbles cannot form, but in the boiling process, bubbles are formed. Last but not the least, the evaporation occurs when the vapor pressure is less than the atmospheric pressure. But the boiling occurs when the vapor pressure is equal to the atmospheric pressure. Okay. Now, so we have discussed that what is evaporation, what is the process of evaporation, why evaporation is a cooling process. Now we should know what are the factors that affecting evaporation. There are some common factors that are affecting evaporation, like vapor pressure, relative humidity, temperature, atmospheric pressure, wind speed, soluble salt, the heat storage in a water body, or you can say also it as size of water body. And the surface area of water body. Okay. So let's discuss. Now, before knowing about the effect of vapor pressure on evaporation, we should know what is vapor pressure is actually. See, the vapor pressure can be defined as the pressure exerted by the vapor at a given temperature in equilibrium state with liquid. See, in this particular definition, this equilibrium word is very important. Okay. If we consider a closed container in which certain amount of water is present. Okay. Now, if we supply heat on that closed container, the water molecules in that closed container will start to evaporate. Okay. Now, the water molecules that start to evaporate, they will also try to condense. So, in this situation, the evaporation and condensation both occurs in that particular containers together. Now, initially, the rate of evaporation will be higher than the rate of condensation. But there will be a situation when the rate of evaporation will be equal to the rate of condensation. That particular situation or that particular stage is called as equilibrium state or equilibrium stage. In that equilibrium stage, the vapor will exert a pressure, and that pressure is known as vapor pressure. Okay. You can see this is the closed container and we supply heat. Okay. We supply heat in this particular container. Now, due to the application of heat, the water molecules from the surface start to evaporate. Okay. Now, in this situation, condensation is also occur in this particular case. Okay. But at this point of time, the rate of evaporation is higher than the rate of condensation. You can see the vaporization rate is greater than the condensation rate. Okay. But after some time, there will be a situation or there will be a stage when the vaporization rate will be equal to the condensation rate. So, this stage is actually equilibrium stage. Okay. Equilibrium stage. Or equilibrium state. And in this equilibrium stage, the vapor will exert a pressure with the liquid. This is known as vapor pressure. Okay. So, see, the effect of vapor pressure on the evaporation can be described by Dalton's law of evaporation. Okay. So, the Dalton's law of evaporation reads, the rate of evaporation is proportional to the difference between the saturation vapor pressure and the actual vapor pressure in the air. Okay. So, this EL is equals to C into EW minus EA. Okay. This EL is rate of evaporation in millimeter per day. EW is the saturation vapor pressure in millimeter of mercury, and this EA is actual vapor pressure in millimeter of mercury, and C is a constant. Okay, so actually this law is EL is proportional to EW minus EA. Okay, so we can say that evaporation is directly proportional to the vapor pressure. Okay, more the vapor pressure, more the evaporation. Okay, now the second factor that affects the evaporation is relative humidity. Now the relative humidity can be defined as the ratio of actual vapor pressure and the saturation vapor pressure. Okay, so you can see this relative humidity can be given by EA by EW. Okay, this EA is actual vapor pressure and EW is saturation vapor pressure. Okay, now the rate of evaporation decreases with an increase in relative humidity. Okay, now this relation can also be explained by the Dalton's law of evaporation. See, according to the Dalton's law of evaporation, the rate of evaporation is directly proportional to saturation vapor pressure minus the actual vapor pressure, right? So from this equation, you may observe that with the increase of EW, the EL is also increasing. Okay, so from this equation, you can conclude that EL is directly proportional to the saturation vapor pressure. Okay, but the relative humidity, this relative humidity is inversely proportional to EW. Okay, so from this two relation, you can conclude that EL means the rate of evaporation is inversely proportional to relative humidity. Okay, now the third factor is temperature. Now if the other factors remain same, the rate of evaporation increases with increase in the water temperature. Okay, it means the rate of evaporation increases with the increase in water temperature. So it is directly proportional to the water temperature. The rate of evaporation is directly proportional to the water temperature. But a high correlation between the evaporation rate and the air temperature doesn't exist. Means the relation between rate of evaporation and water temperature exists, but there is no high correlation between the rate of evaporation and the temperature of air. Although there is a general increase in the evaporation rate with the increase in air temperature. Okay, so we can write that in general rate of evaporation will increase with the increase in air temperature. Okay, but it may or may not be true for a given situation. Okay, now the fourth factor that affect the evaporation is atmospheric pressure. The evaporation rate decreases with an increase in the atmospheric pressure. Okay, this atmospheric pressure is nothing but the actual vapor pressure in mm of mercury. Okay, and if you recall the Dalton's law of evaporation, see, this is the Dalton's law of evaporation, this is our rate of evaporation, this is evaporation rate, and this is our actual vapor pressure, or you can write it as atmospheric pressure. Okay, now from this equation you may conclude that with the increase in atmospheric pressure, the rate of evaporation is decreases. It is common mathematics that if we increase this, the value of Ea, this whole expression will decrease, and if this whole expression will decrease, the El will also decrease. That is why we can write that the evaporation rate will decrease if you increase the atmospheric pressure. Okay, now one of the most important factors that affects the evaporation is wind speed. Okay, now wind aid in removing the evaporated water vapor from the zone of evaporation and consequently creates the greater scope for evaporation. However, if the wind velocity is large enough to remove all the evaporated water vapor, any further increase in the wind velocity does not affect the evaporation. Hence, the evaporation rate increases with the increase in wind speed up to a critical speed. Okay, means the rate of evaporation increases with the wind speed up to a certain speed, beyond which any further increase in wind speed doesn't affect the evaporation rate. See what this actually point says. Suppose we have a water body, okay. This is a water body. Okay, now we have also sun. Suppose this is our sun. Okay, now due to the solar radiation, the water molecules from the water body will start to evaporate, right? So the water molecules will start evaporating. Okay, see, the water molecules start evaporating. Okay, now once this water molecules converted into vapor and start to travel into atmosphere, they will accumulate here. Okay, this evaporated water vapors will accumulate here. Okay, now since they are accumulated here, there will be no scope for further evaporation. Okay, since they are accumulated here, they jam this zone of evaporation. Okay, now due to this jam in the zone of evaporation, there will be no further scope for evaporation. Now in this situation, suppose a high speed wind is flowing from this side. Now this high speed wind may remove certain amount of evaporated water vapor that was accumulated here. Okay, so if this wind removes certain amount of water vapor which was accumulated here, then there will a scope created for further evaporation. Okay, so this is only written over here. Okay, now if the wind velocity is large enough that that wind remove all the water vapors, all the evaporated water vapors from this evaporation zone, then any further increase in wind velocity doesn't affect the evaporation, because once all the accumulated evaporated water removed, then it doesn't matter how much the wind velocity is or how much the wind speed is, it will not further increase the scope of evaporation or rate of evaporation. Okay, it means the rate of evaporation will increase with the speed of wind up to a certain speed of wind, and this certain amount of speed of wind is known as critical speed, beyond which any further increase in velocity of wind, there will be no effect on the rate of evaporation. Okay. So, see, from this figure, you may understand how this wind speed affects the evaporation. See, initially with the increase of wind speed or velocity of wind, the rate of evaporation will also increase. Okay. But in a certain wind speed, which is known as critical wind speed, after that wind speed, any further increase in the velocity of wind or speed of wind, the evaporation rate will not change, because this speed, this wind speed is the large enough which is able to remove all the water vapor that was evaporated and accumulated on the zone of evaporation. So, any further increase in the wind speed, the rate of evaporation will not increase. Okay. So, this is the critical wind speed. Now, the soluble salt also affect the rate of evaporation. The percent reduction in the evaporation is approximately corresponds to the percentage increase in the specific gravity of water. It means, suppose if we increase the 1% of specific gravity of water, then it leads the 1% decrease in the rate of evaporation. Okay, so if we increase the 1% specific gravity of water, or you can say specific density of water, then 1% of rate of evaporation will decrease. It means the amount of soluble salt is inversely proportional to the rate of evaporation. Okay. Now, under identical condition, the evaporation from seawater is 2 to 3% less from fresh water. Okay. Since the seawater is having much more, you know, solute dissolved in that is why it is showing almost 2 to 3% less rate of evaporation compared to the fresh water, because fresh water is having less amount of dissolved solid or solute. Okay. So, basically the soluble salt causes reduction in the rate of evaporation. Now the next factor is heat storage in the water bodies. Okay. Now the deep water bodies have more heat storage than the shallow ones. Okay. And a deep lake may store radiation energy received in the summer and released it in the winter, which causes the less evaporation in the summer and more evaporation in the winter, unlike the shallow lakes. Okay. So, actually, what it says, see, suppose we have a shallow lake, okay. Maybe this is a shallow lake and this is a deep lake. Okay. This is a deep lake. The shallow lake is having a less depth of water because it is a shallow lake, and a deep lake is having a large depth of water because obviously it is a deep lake. Now what happened in the summer? In summer, since the depth of the water in the shallow lake is less, the whole depth of water, this whole depth of water will be hot, okay, due to the temperature of, you know, surrounding atmosphere. But in the case of deep water, this situation is a bit different. Due to the surrounding atmospheric temperature, the upper portion of this lake will be hotter compared to the lower portion of this water. Okay, this lower portion of this lake will be cold compared to the upper portion. Okay, because this upper portion will directly, you know, exposed to the atmosphere. And since in the summer the atmospheric temperature is high, that is why this upper portion will hotter compared to lower portion. Now since this water body is having hotter water, means hot water and cold water both, the average temperature in the summer for the deep water body will be less compared to the shallow water bodies, because in shallow water bodies the average temperature will the same as the average temperature of the atmosphere. But in this case, for the case of deep water body, the average temperature will be less compared to the surrounding atmosphere. That is why in the summer the shallow lakes experiences more evaporation, okay, but the deep water bodies having less evaporation in the summer. Now if you consider the same situation for winter, it will be different. Let us consider the winter situation. Okay, see, in winter what happens, see, suppose we have a shallow lake and we have a deep lake. Okay, now in shallow lake we have less depth of water as we described, okay, and in the deep lake we have large depth of water. Okay, now in the winter season, the throughout depth of the shallow water will be cooler, right, because the surrounding atmosphere is having less temperature. That is why the whole depth of the shallow water will be cooler. But this is not the same case for deep water bodies, because in the winter situation the upper portion or the upper surface of the deep water body will be cooler and the lower portion of the deep water body will be hotter, okay, because they had stored some amount of heat from the summer season. So in the winter, this is the case for winter, okay. So in the winter season, the average temperature of the deep water body will be higher compared to the shallow water body. Okay, this is our shallow water body, right, and this is our deep water body. Okay, so the average temperature of the deep water body will be high compared to shallow water body. Okay, so since the high average temperature in the winter season for the deep water body, that is why in the winter season the deep water body will experience higher amount of evaporation. But in the winter season the shallow water body will experience less amount of evaporation. Okay, so this is the concept of heat storage of the water body. Now last is the surface area. Now how can this surface area affect the evaporation? Let's discuss. See, suppose we have a plane surface, okay, this is the plane surface, and we have a concave surface, okay, this is concave surface, and we also have a convex surface. Okay, this is our plane surface, this is our concave surface, and this is our convex surface. Okay, now if we consider a constant amount of volume, suppose this is the area is A and the height is h, okay, the volume is A into H. Okay, volume is have to be constant. Okay, now in this case, for the case of this concave surface, see, the height has increased. Okay, if we consider this constant volume V, since the height has increased, see, the height has increased compared to this H, right? Suppose this is H dash, so the H dash is greater than H. Okay, so since this height has increased, to keep the volume constant, we need to decrease the area, decrease the surface area. We need to decrease the surface area. Suppose this is the surface area, then we need to decrease the surface area, and hence this A dash is less than A. Okay, so in this situation, the surface area has decreased. Okay, now if we consider this convex surface, now in this convex surface, the height has decreased. Okay, this height, suppose H double dash, this height has increased, sorry, decreased. So the height has decreased for the convex surface. Now to keep the volume constant, we need to increase the surface area. Okay, so this, suppose this is the surface area for this convex surface, and this is suppose A double dash. So this A double dash is greater than A. Okay, so from this illustration, you may understand that for the convex surface, the surface area is increased. Okay, and it has been seen that the convex surface area is having more amount of evaporation. Means if the water surface is convex, though it is not possible in practical way, but still, if the water surface is convex, then the rate of evaporation is higher. So from that, you know, relation, we can also conclude that with the increase of surface area, the, you know, evaporation is also increases, because the surface area is increases in the case of, you know, convex water surface. Okay, so the volume of water lost by the evaporation, means the rate of evaporation, is directly proportional to the surface area of a water body. Okay, so this is it for today. We will meet in the next class. Till then, stay safe and stay happy. Thank you.